Good morning. My name is Christian Kopeng. Welcome to the Chapel of the Resurrection. Today is the third Sunday in Easter. A special welcome to those worshiping via our live stream and via Valpo's radio station, WVUR, The Source. The resources you need for worship this morning are in the booklet you received when you entered and the red book located in the shelf in a chair in front of you. Offering will be received by passing a basket, or you can give a gift to the chapel's ministry by using the QR code on page 2. When it comes time for communion, an usher will invite you forward. Please stop at the hand sanitizer station and then pick up a cup from the table. Approach the servers to receive the sacrament. You may receive both the bread and the wine, or either one. We believe that Christ is fully present in both. The communion bread is gluten and dairy free, and there's dealkalized wine available. Just ask the assisting minister for it when they come to you with wine. As you prepare to receive bread, make a manger like this with your hands. When receiving the wine, we ask you to hold your empty cup out so that we can fill it. If you'd like to receive a blessing instead of the bread and wine, please cross your arms over your body like this. Place your empty cup in the wooden bowl over there, and then there's hand sanitizer for your use on the way out. If stairs are an obstacle for you, please tell the usher when you're invited forward, and we would love to bring communion to you. Blessings on your worship today.
Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, the strength of our ancestors, the host of this meal, and the builder of the city that is to come. Amen. If we have died with Christ, we will also live with Christ. Let us confess our sin to the one who is faithful. God, our helper, we confess the many ways we have failed to live as your disciples. We have not finished what we began. We have feasted with friends but ignored strangers. We have been captivated by our possessions. Lift our burdens, gracious God. Refresh our hearts and forgive our sin. Raise us to new life you have chosen for us. In Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. There is rejoicing in heaven when sinners repent. Put your trust in these promises. God will never leave you or forsake you. You who were lost have been found. For the sake of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. Rejoice with the angels at this good news. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Let us pray. Holy and righteous God, you are the author of life, and you adopt us to be your children. Fill us with your words of life, that we may live as witnesses to the resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
A reading from Acts. Peter addressed the people. You Israelites, why do you wonder at this? Or why do you stare at us, as though by our own power or piety we had made this man walk? The God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob, the God of our ancestors, has glorified his servant Jesus, whom you handed over and rejected in the presence of Pilate, though he had decided to release him. But you rejected the Holy and Righteous One and asked to have a murderer given to you, and you killed the author of life, whom God raised from the dead. To this we are witnesses, and by faith in his name itself has made this man strong, whom you see and know. And the faith that is through Jesus has given him this perfect health in the presence of all of you. And now, friends, I know that you acted in ignorance, as did also your rulers. In this way, God fulfilled what he had foretold through all the prophets, that his Messiah would suffer. Repent, therefore, and turn to God, so that your sins may be wiped out. The word of the Lord.
Do not sin. Speak to your heart. heart in silence upon your bed. Appointed sacrifices and put your trust in the Lord. Many are saying, who will show us any good? Let the light of your face shine upon us, O Lord. You have put gladness in my heart more than when grain and wine abound. In peace I will lie down and sleep, for you alone, O Lord, make me rest secure.
Reading from 1 John. See what love the Father has given us, that we should be called children of God, and that is what we are. The reason the world does not know us is that it did not know him. Beloved, we are God's children now. What we will be has not yet been revealed. What we do know is this: when he is revealed, we will be like him, for we will see him as he is. And all who have this hope in him purify themselves, just as he is pure. Everyone who commits sin is guilty of lawlessness. Sin is lawlessness. You know that he was revealed to take away sins, and in him there is no sin. No one who abides in him sins. No one who sins has either seen him or known him. Little children, let no one deceive you. Everyone who does what is right is righteous, just as he is righteous. The word of the Lord.
Holy Gospel according to Luke. Jesus himself stood among the disciples and said to them, "Peace be with you." They were startled and terrified and thought that they were seeing a ghost. He said to them, "Why are you frightened? And why do doubts arise in your hearts? Look at my hands and my feet. See that it is I myself. Touch me and see. For a ghost does not have flesh and bones, as you see that I have." And when he had said this, he showed them his hands and his feet. While in their joy they were disbelieving and still wondering, he said to them, "Have you anything here to eat?" They gave him a piece of broiled fish, and he took it and ate it in their presence. Then he said to them, "These are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms must be fulfilled." Then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures, and he said to them, "Thus it is written that the Messiah is to suffer and to rise from the dead on the third day, and that repentance and forgiveness of sins is to be proclaimed in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things." The Gospel of the Lord. I am sure you could name a lot of stories about people coming back from the dead in one form or another. Maybe the prevalence of these stories in our culture, and probably in all cultures, comes from our longing to feel a connection with those people that we miss.
Many of the most common stories tell of someone coming back in this spiritual, non-physical form, like the voice of a loved one speaking through a medium or see-through spirits that remain in the houses where something terrible happened to them. In Star Wars, Obi-Wan Kenobi continues to appear after his death in a bluish, ghost-like form or as a disembodied voice in Luke's head, and he's there to give Luke guidance along his way to becoming a Jedi. And in all of these spiritual return stories, a person's body is gone, but they are still able to reach the land of the living in these non-physical ways. Then there's this other set of stories about the dead that are more physical. Stories of zombies or vampires, these people whose bodies remain even though their spirits or identities have somehow and dramatically been changed. In a reference that I'm sure is starting to get out of date, in Game of Thrones, many characters come back from the dead, bodies and all. Some are changed or kind of empty of their personality. Some of them are ice zombies. But others are raised to be essentially the same person they were before the death, their death. The land of the living gets them back again. And on Easter Sunday, I preached about how Jesus' resurrection initiated a cosmological change. After worship, a student came up to me and asked me a few questions about that. And he was rightly curious because, and he pointed this out, the Bible actually itself contains a lot of stories of people coming back from the dead. So Jesus is not entirely unique in that sense. Lazarus is probably the most famous of the people who came back. Jesus raised him from the dead after he'd been in the tomb for 4 days. And even though people warned him in the elegant language of the King James Bible, "Lord, by this time he stinketh." Jesus also raised a couple of other people that we know about, a widow's son and the daughter of a synagogue leader. In the Old Testament, both the prophet Elijah and his protege Elisha raised children from the dead. And there's this moment where King Saul uses a medium to talk to the prophet Samuel again after Samuel has died. By far, my favorite of the Bible stories of someone being raised from the dead is when St. Paul is preaching late into the night, and there's a young man sitting in the window who falls asleep, quote, "while Paul talked still longer," end quote, and the young man falls out the window down 3 stories and dies. So St. Paul gets up, stops preaching, goes downstairs, raises the man back to life, says to the people, "don't be alarmed," and then goes on preaching some more. The story of Jesus' resurrection, though, doesn't really fit into the models of stories that we're seeing in these other places, even in Scripture. We can divide these other stories mostly either into spiritual returns or physical returns. But Jesus' resurrection really messes up that boundary. Like in today's gospel reading, when the disciples are gathered together in a room and suddenly Jesus appears among them. It doesn't sound like he uses a door. And in the story that comes right before this story in the Gospel of Luke, this is the Road to Emmaus story for those of you who know it, the resurrected Christ is sitting at a table with a couple of other disciples who up to this point have totally not realized it's Jesus they're talking to, even though they're talking about Jesus. And then he suddenly vanishes from their sight. Again, not walking away, not using a door, suddenly vanishing from their sight, says Luke. And that kind of behavior we usually associate with spirit types, with ghosts and things like that. And yet, in today's reading, we also hear how Jesus was hungry and ate a piece of fish, which is something the resurrected Christ also does in other stories we have in the Scriptures. And it's something that requires a physical working body. Now, I don't know about you all, but that kind of stuff is really hard for me to wrap my brain around. Was Jesus' resurrection physical? Did his body return to life? Yes. He even told his disciples to touch the wounds left by his crucifixion. Could Jesus appear and disappear at will, whether or not walls were in the way? Apparently, yes to that too. How can all those things be true at once? When people ask me the question, if someone has never really read the Bible before, but they want to start reading it, where would I recommend they start? My answer is to pick up a copy of one of these books, which is N.T. Wright's The New Testament for Everyone series, and specifically one of his commentaries on the Gospels. I think actually this specific book was just given back to me by Sean because I had done this for him for Lent last year. I really love these books because N.T. Wright is that rare person who is both a really fantastic scholar and a really fantastic pastor. So these books, you get his knowledge of the history and the theology of interpretation of these texts, but he makes it simple, and he adds a devotional element to each of his commentaries, so I can't recommend this enough. That plug is also a transition back to this question that I'm sure both new Bible readers and longtime Bible students have about Jesus' resurrection appearances, which is, what in the world is going on here? How can he just appear, but then eat food, and then disappear again? And N.T. Wright addresses that question, as well as the question of what Jesus' resurrection in that way might mean for the way Scripture talks about the resurrection of the dead in general. And that is the promise that God will one day raise all of God's people from the dead. And here's what N.T. Wright writes about that. People often think that resurrection simply means life after death or going to heaven, but in the Jewish world of the first century, it meant a new embodied life in God's new world, a life after death, if you like. But the new body which will be given at the end is not identical to the previous one. In an act of new creation, parallel only to the original creation itself, God will make a new type of material, no longer subject to death, out of the old one. The new body will belong in both the dimensions of God's world, in both heaven and earth. At the end of the book of Revelation, it says that one day heaven and earth will finally be joined together into one. So there won't be any more shuttling to and fro. The two dimensions will be fused together at last. At the moment, our bodies are earthly only. Jesus' new body is at home in both earth and heaven. And if our mental pictures of heaven need adjusting to allow for this startling possibility, so be it. Only this explains the otherwise very puzzling stories here in the Gospel of Luke and in John's similar account. Of course, the resurrection and the ascension stretch our minds and imaginations further than we would normally like. We who live even as Christians with our thinking conditioned by the world of sin and death find it a huge struggle to adjust to God's new world. This is part of the challenge of the gospel. If you'd like to read more about that, but not from N.T. Wright, but from the scriptures, the answer is 1 Corinthians chapter 15, but Paul is much more confusing than N.T. Wright is. Christ's resurrected body was one more and even bigger way that God shows us that the life, death, and resurrection of Christ, in that heaven and earth come together. That resurrected body was both totally earthly, having a snack, and totally miraculous, revealing to us the nature of Christ. God's perfect realm and the broken worldly realm, the eternal and the mortal, the divine and the human, these things were united in Christ so that we too might be restored to unity with God. As the ancient Easter proclamation, which you may have heard at the Easter Vigil service, says of Christ's resurrection day, "This is the night when heaven and earth are joined, things human and things divine." People experience this unity of the divine and the human in Jesus' life, too. They saw this man, dusty from travel, bitten by bugs, hungry like they were, and maybe even he stanketh sometimes, too. They saw him heal people and multiply food. In his teachings, they heard the clarity of God's truth. Through his anger at those who mistreated others, they glimpsed God's justice. Through his compassion and forgiveness, they felt God's love and grace. In Jesus, they saw God at work. Jesus' arrest and humiliation and crucifixion must have called all of that into question. Suffering usually makes us question whether God is on someone's side, or whether God is there, or whether God is real. The disciples must have questioned if they'd had it all wrong, if they'd been foolish to think that God was there with and in that carpenter's son from Nazareth. The first thing the resurrected Christ does when he sees them is explain from the scriptures. Thus it is written that the Messiah is to suffer and to rise from the dead on the third day. In other words, of course God had not abandoned Jesus. God had shown over and over throughout the history of Israel that God is able to work through the horrible things that humans do to one another, that God can bring new meaning and new life even out of suffering and death. Yet this can be so hard to believe for the disciples and for us. When God resurrected Jesus, God showed once and for all that Jesus was sent by God, was God's Messiah, was God's Son, and even, as Christians soon came to confess, God made flesh, fully divine and fully human. And the resurrection was a sign that Jesus' work was not done. Death had not stopped it. He rose to pass his mission on to his disciples. He not only explained to them that he was the Messiah, he also taught them that repentance and forgiveness of sins is to be proclaimed in his name to all nations. That's what he tells his disciples in today's story. Now, the church was to be Christ's body, the people through whom God would continue to touch the earth. And even though we wait for the final resurrection, we, the church, are the place where people can see heaven and earth joined together. And people will see that in us as we embody what Jesus taught us. Last month, I was on a spring break service trip to southern Georgia in an area that had been hit by 4 or 5 tornadoes in January of 2023. And if you were at Celebrate, don't worry, this is a different story. One day, our site manager drove me around in his truck, giving me a quick tour of the town, pointing out all the destruction that was still so obvious a year later. Houses with roofs caved in, lines of trees that had a split down the middle. And he told me stories of the psychological trauma that people were still experiencing in that community. He also pointed out places where it was not at all obvious that a tornado had come through. The places that had more insurance, more wealth, more social priority, that had already been rebuilt and looked like they were doing fine. Along the way, he mentioned that he'd been talking with the city manager about this group of college students from Indiana who were coming down to help. And she, the city manager, was totally surprised to hear that we were willing to go and do work in those neighborhoods where houses were still collapsed. They were places of poverty and struggle, places that many would have judged as run down even before the tornadoes, places that locals still referred to as the other side of the tracks. And when he said that she was surprised that we wanted to go there, all I could think was, but of course that's where we want to go. That's where Jesus would go, wherever people need him. Friends, when we follow in the way of Jesus, it can arouse just as much curiosity as the resurrected Christ suddenly appearing in a room and asking for a snack. Humble service is shocking. Generosity is shocking. Repentance, admitting that we are wrong to another human being, that is shocking. Forgiveness is shocking. Worship is weird and shocking. Relying on something outside of ourselves is shocking. So let your light shine, because in your light, other people will see the light of heaven. Amen.
Thank you.
the waters of baptism, we have been made people of God. Living together in trust and hope, we confess our faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Sustained and nurtured by our generous God, we gather as one to pray for the church, the world, and all of God's creation.
Holy and powerful God, in the resurrection of Jesus, you have shown us that you stand forever on the side of life and renewal. We pray for all those called to follow your Spirit's work on our campus, especially for the staff and volunteers who lead Sunday morning worship, candlelight, celebrate, and morning prayer. Guide them to craft worship services that make a special place for people to encounter your life-giving love for them and the world. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for those who hold political leadership, locally, nationally, and internationally. Give them ears to hear your wisdom. Give them hearts that break with compassion for those they serve. Give them hands that hold power gently. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for students as we work through a final month of projects, papers, and exams. Bless us with focus and energy to complete our many tasks. Bless our rest, our play, and our worship, so that it will renew our minds and our spirits. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for student artists, performers, and musicians. Be with them through all upcoming shows, concerts, and recitals. We ask that they would experience not only success in their skills, but also the joy and meaning of their art. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for all those whose compassion is also their work, especially for teachers, researchers, students, and coaches. As they attend to their duties, may they also continuously find curiosity, joy, and excitement in their work. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for scientists and educators who work to share knowledge for the good of the world. May we listen and learn from them well. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for all those who are suffering in body, mind, or spirit, especially those we name now, out loud or silently. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We give you thanks because you hold us forever in your life. We remember those we love who have died, and we pray that you would comfort all who grieve. Remind us that we are still and forever connected with the saints who have come before us. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer. Assured by your promise to hear us, we lay our prayers before your throne of grace through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Let us pray. God, our provider, will bring nothing into this world, and we can take nothing out of it. Accept the gifts you have first given us,
which we bring to your table, and with them the offering of our lives. Nourish us now with the life that really is life, revealed to us in Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so, with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy God, holy and mighty, holy and immortal, we praise and glorify you. You we worship and adore. You formed the earth from chaos. You encircled the globe with air. You created fire for warmth and light. You nourished the lands with water. You molded us in your image, and with mercy higher than the mountains, with grace deeper than the seas, you blessed the Israelites and cherished them as your own, that also we, estranged and dying, might be adopted to live in your spirit. You called to us through the life and death of Jesus. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." And after supper, he took the cup. He gave thanks and he gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Together as the body of Christ, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. With this bread and cup, we remember your Son, the firstborn of your new creation. We remember his life lived for others, and his death and resurrection, which renews the face of the earth. We await his coming, when with all the world made perfect through your wisdom, all our sins and sorrows will be no more. Amen. Come, Lord Jesus. Holy God, holy and merciful one, holy and compassionate, Send upon us and upon this meal your Holy Spirit, whose breath revives us for life and whose fire rouses us to love. Enfold in your arms all who share this holy food. We pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done. Forever and ever. Amen. Jesus welcomes sinners and eats with them. Come, take your place at the feast.
Thank you.
the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ keep you in his grace. Amen.
Let us pray. God of blessing, at this table we have seen you face to face, and in the gift of Christ's body and blood, our hearts have been refreshed.
Send us now to shine with your goodness and bear witness to the one we have received, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. The Holy Three, the Holy One, increase your hope, strengthen your faith, deepen your love, and grant you peace. Amen.
Go in peace. Live in life as Christ loved us.
Thanks be to God.